Joining us to talk more about today's vote is Terry Haynes from Evercore ISI and David Bahnsen from HighTower's Bahnsen Group. Welcome, guys. Thank you for being here. Terry, let me just start with you, because you still think the odds of success here are pretty high, even after Ron Johnson came out against this yesterday. Why?
Well, fundamentally, Kelly, it's not a matter of...
Hang on, guys.
Terry,
one at a time. Terry Haynes first.
Thank you. Thank you, Bill. Fundamentally, it's not... I think what's happening here is that, you know, what Ron Johnson wants, for example, is he wants some work done on pass-throughs. He said that. He said that he's interested in working. The leadership has said they're interested in working with him. Got to figure out how to get to yes. That's always the case in Senate legislation, and I think the markets have not seen major legislation other than spending bills pass for about 7 or 8 years now. So you're going to have to get used to a little bit of this rope-a-dope. But fundamentally, there's no reason to assume that the Senate's not going to be on board when the time comes.
And David, what were you going to say?
I'm sorry about that. Yeah, what I was going to say
That's right.
I think that they have already done the political discounting as to what they have to do to get different people on board. I thought it was very interesting this week that the assumption was by adding this repeal of the Obamacare mandate, they thought they were going to lose some votes, whether it be McCain or Susan Collins, somebody like that, when in reality, what I think they were doing was picking up Rand Paul's vote. So there's a lot of intentional political work going on. And to his point, the Ron Johnson issue, I think, is wise for Senator Johnson to hold to some leverage going into conference to kind of get some improvement and clarity and flatlining around that pass-through treatment. Senator Johnson's not going to get everything he wants, but I think he's going to get enough to get him on board and probably improve the bill in the meantime.
Terry, what's that going to look like if they're, you know, everything you want to give back to someone costs you money? So if they do something to placate him, does that mean more temporary cuts and that sort of thing?
Well, my view of this, Kelly, all along has been really two things. One, markets need to understand that we're in a substance-free zone now. What this is about holding on to the fundamentals of tax reform and at the same time bringing up the pay-fors enough to be able to pay for it. So yeah, there's gonna be a little bit of horse trading that goes on, but fundamentally what this is about holding on to the structure of aggressive corporate tax cuts, the individual tax cuts that have been talked about, and keeping it within the budgetary lines of this small static increase in deficits that's been agreed to by the House and the Senate. Everything else is fungible, but everything else is less important than getting those things done for politicians.
David, I'm getting slightly ahead of ourselves here since the Senate bill hasn't passed by any means, but given the margin of victory for the Republicans today in the House, they've got some room to give here. Do you think that maybe the bill that finally comes out of conference will have to look more like the Senate since they have more onerous rules, the Byrd rule and so forth, than the House does right now?
There's no question, and there's another reason for it too, Bill. The House, after the Senate passes their bill, is going to have unbelievable political pressure to basically just take what's been given to them. I think that what the Senate ends up approving will be what the final bill ends up being, with maybe a couple minor tweaks. I agree with what Terry said,
does that mean that you expect a one-year delay in the corporate tax cut, seven individual rates rather than the four in the House bill, and no deductions for the state and local taxes? I mean, is that what we're really looking at realistically here?
So there's sort of different answers to each of those things. I think that what the Senate ends up approving is going to be very similar to what the final bill ends up being. But the final Senate bill, I think, is going to have changes primarily on that corporate tax start. I do not think they're going to hold 2019. I think it will come forward to 2018. And I think that's a lot of what the pay for is from the Obamacare repeal. The SALT, so-called state local tax deductibility,
right.
I think that that's a goner. And I think that the House was where they were going to have problems there. They've obviously gotten through that. But I think that really from an investor standpoint, even though it is true that the basic framework is kind of there, it's corporate tax reform driven, there are a couple weeds still that matter. And I think the interest deductibility for the companies, what formula they use, you can see volatility in some of the MLPs and some of the asset managers. There's still some issues that, even though broadly are kind of granular, I think have a big investment implication.
Terry, we're out of time, but just in a word, do you think the Senate will still have to delay that corporate tax cut?
I think the final version of this makes corporate tax cuts effective in 2018. I've always said so.
Wow.
I still think so.
All right. We will see. Thank you, guys. Terry Haynes, David Bahnsen, thanks for joining us today.